Welcome, everybody, to Cincinnati Bengals Weekly Show on the Grueling Crew Sports Network. The Cincinnati Bengals Weekly Show is brought to you by Dr. Randall Fick Chiropractic in Springdale, Ohio. For all your chiropractic needs, make sure you get a hold of Dr. Fick. I'm your host for the show, Mike Goodpaster. Right now, I want to welcome in my co-host, Joe Kelly. How you doing, Joe?
Mike, it's been better days, man. Better days. You know, we went into Pittsburgh. I went in there with a lot of expectations, with a lot of hope. But at the end of the day, I think we just gave up. At some point in time in the second half, that desire, Mike, that desire wasn't there. I didn't see it, you know, especially didn't see it offensively. And defensively, I think this game was one of was probably the worst game the defense played. You know, they gave up 29 points, but they were giving up crucial third down conversions at crucial times. That they were, you know, allowing Pittsburgh to make the plays when Pittsburgh needed to make the plays, and when we needed to stop them, Mike, we couldn't. So there was a lot of situations. I really was expecting Dunlap to really dominate the guy that was standing in. You know, I was expecting our D-line to really dominate, to get some push, and we did. So when our core, the base of our team, our the best part of our team, our defensive front seven, when they're losing the line of scrimmage, Mike, we're going to have days like we did on Sunday.
Yeah, and, I mean, the thing that concerns me the most about this team is they were coming off two straight wins. They had a bye week while Pittsburgh had to play a physical game with Kansas City, and the Bengals just looked unprepared. I mean, the Steelers seemed like they always burned the Bengals on a trick play, but I don't even think that was a called trick play. It was the fact that we didn't cover the gunner, so they just tossed it out there. And then you look at the look on Mike Tomlin's face, and he just looks like he just stole something. And, I mean, in a way that basically mocked the Cincinnati Bengals again. I mean, this team was unprepared. And you look, halftime adjustments. First half, the Bengals moved the ball. Joe Mixon's running the ball. They're throwing the ball. But the thing I noticed was this. In the first half, to me, it looked like they were playing a lot of cover one man. In the second half, the Bengals made no adjustments, and the Steelers went to a cover two and started double-teaming A.J. Green. They took the pass away. But the Bengals still kept trying to pass, which makes no sense to me, Joe.
Yeah. It's like you said, there's when you look at a football game and you look back and you're able to examine it, every game, it comes down to some plays. But then, you know, it comes down to will. You see the team, they made some adjustments. And it wasn't like, you know, we were hitting them with a lot of big plays, but they made some minor adjustments. And they affected our offense. And then in return, we didn't make the adjustments. There was a lot of things that we could have done. We could have went to, you know, some short passes. We could have went to some screens. We could have, you know, did some quick flares. We could have got Giovanni out in space against a linebacker. There was so many things that, you know, we could have done. You looked at, you know, defensively. You go back to that special teams play. That's, like you said, you had 2 weeks to prepare. That should never happen. But the fact that it happens after a bye week, you get out there and there's absolutely nobody covering the gunner, it's totally unexcusable. It's totally coach-related. You know, there's no excuse for something to happen like that at this level, Mike.
Well, and the thing is this, the Bengals, since Marvin Lewis has been here, 5-9-1 after the bye week. To me, that's unacceptable. If you've got a well-coached team, I bet if we check out Bill Belichick, John Harbaugh's record, it's not like that. And, I mean, I hate to beat a dead horse, which I think he is now. I think he came into this season as a lame duck. I mean, he had no contract extension. I think that he's going to be fired by the end of the season. And I think he has to be. I think he's a good football coach. But sometimes a good coach can just stay someplace too long. And I think it's gotten old here. I think he's lost the players' respect just because of a lot of things that happened that weren't even his fault. So, I mean, I think there has to be a coaching change at some point, either during the season or after the season. And, I mean, I hate to see it happen to him because he's done a great job to take this from a terrible team to a team that's respectable. But the problem is, if you stay too long, respectable goes back to terrible. And I just think that they need a change soon.
Yeah. You look at it, like you said, at this point in time, you look at where we're going, you know, in the season, the players that we have, you know, we don't have Eifert, but even that being said, we still have the personnel.
I don't think we do, Joe. I think that personnel was given away when you gave away Whitworth and Zeitler.
Well, yeah. I mean, you look, but you're still. We're talking about one player. Even if you kept one of those guys, you know, even if you kept just one of those guys, you know, overall, when you look at our personnel, you look at it across the board, across the league, and you know what other teams are doing. You know, Pittsburgh, they're down one guy. One guy steps in, you know, and it keeps
The difference between the Bengals and the Steelers, Joe, is this. Over the last 5 years, they've built an offensive line through the draft, and the Bengals have constantly whiffed on draft picks.
Yeah, well, that's the biggest thing. If we want to pinpoint something, you're looking at Abwehi and you're looking at Fisher, first round pick, a second round pick.
Well, and Bo Dine.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, when you look at them, Mike, you look at what they're doing and what they've achieved. And you know, I was first round pick. You know, I didn't make the Pro Bowl, but when I played, you know, I was a bona fide legitimate starter. You know, I made plays. You know, I was consistent. So in that first round pick, you're looking for somebody to at least be competitive. You know, I'm going to be competitive. I'm not going to hurt the team. You know, there's going to be a lot of times they run my way when it's time to get that third and one. You can run behind me. With those two guys, in my opinion, they're totally missing. You know,
yeah, a first round draft choice has to be a difference maker. And you compared it to yourself. I mean, you were a difference maker because you could run, you could cover. I mean, you were what the Bengals needed. They already had Reggie. I mean, they needed somebody to compliment him. You compliment him. That made it a good pick. With Cedric Ogbuehi, when you're a first-round pick and you're a left tackle, when the Bengals give up Andrew Whitworth, one of the best tackles in football, the only way you're not a bust is if you could step in for him. And he just hasn't been able to do it.
Yeah. I mean, I totally agree, man. I'm with you, man. And
the same thing with Fisher. Fisher might even be worse if that's possible.
Yeah. You know, and it's unfortunate. I mean, you look at that, and you look at those. If had we hit the mark on those two guys, I don't think I know we would be having this different conversation because even at the end of the day, even with us allowing Pittsburgh 29 points, you're talking about two more scores and a field goal, and with two legitimate tackles in the game at all times, I think here we could stay. We went away from the run. But you know, Andy can get in. Will be allowed to get in his progressions, you know, and make some plays. And when you guys are just these guys are whiffing at the line of scrimmage, you know, and you're looking at that, you know, it causes a total breakdown, you know, of the offense. And again, you know, I'm still an Andy Dalton supporter, regardless of somebody. I think he, you know, when it's fourth down and you got to make a play. At the end of the day, man, I think players today are more worried about their stats these days and looking good. But when you're in a situation that Andy was in, it was fourth down, and we have to make a play, you throwing it up in the stands, there is not a chance in hell that anything's going to happen. But if you throw it in the direction of AJ, you give AJ the opportunity to make a great play. Throw the ball and give somebody. So you never know. I mean, it was a long shot, but at the end of the day, you don't throw it away in the stands and score down. You have to make.
Yeah, but Joe, I mean, that kind of gets solidified when the Pittsburgh Steelers have so much lack of respect for your team that they take three knees and punt the ball to you, and then the Bengals immediately just take a knee. And I'm sorry, I know the game's probably over, but damn it, I'm just tired of the quitting and the giving up. And Andy Dalton did it, but then Marvin Lewis did it. I mean, so it's kind of the culture here now. This team has turned into that. And I still think it all goes back to the wild card game a couple years ago. I think that pretty much sealed the deal on that, on this team's window to be able to win. And then you pick up John Ross and Joe Mixon. I love those draft picks. But the problem is you could have traded down that ninth pick and maybe picked up two or three linemen in this draft, which if you look at the Philadelphia Eagles are so good now because they needed a running back. They went out and they signed LeGarrette Blount. They needed offensive linemen. They drafted them. I mean, but the Bengals continue to just stockpile skill position players without the ability to give Andy Dalton a chance to get him the ball because there's no offensive line in front of him.
Yeah, you know, it's unfortunate because when you look at that and you take a look at what Mixon has done already and John Ross's potential, you know, you have two incredible upsides. But at the end of the day, when you look at what was the immediate need, or what is the immediate need right now, and we see how bad the offensive tackles are, obviously it seems as though that we should have went after linemen.
All fairness, the center and the guard suck too.
Yes.
Even if we had two good tackles, I mean, last year we had Zeiler, one of the best guards in football, Whitworth, one of the best tackles in football, and they still gave up 40 sacks.
Yeah.
But now the question is this. I mean, Dalton's limping all the time. It's not going to be long before he's down, because if you can't protect him, eventually he's going to get hurt. You can only get hit so many times. And I just think a change in culture with this team is needed. Just they need somebody to come in and bust some ass.
Yeah.
Kind of like the Forrest Gregg in 1980.
I'm with you, Mike. What I see, even for the first time, when I see a lack of toughness, when it looks like the team has given up, you know, that's a tough call, man. It's a tough call, and at some point in time, you know, these guys are professionals, and you're looking at the organization, you're looking at the expectations of the organization, you know, and when you for instance, when you bring up Pittsburgh, you know, Pittsburgh draft tough players, and even guys that didn't really were tough. You know, Ben Roethlisberger wasn't a tough guy at Miami of Ohio. But
he was, Joe. That was a top 10 team when he was there. He took some shots.
But it's still Miami of Ohio, Mike. Understand, it's Miami of Ohio. You know, I'm just saying this tough guy will come in. And
come on, Joe. It don't mean he's not tough just because he didn't play in the Pac-10.
You look at guys. You guys, when they get to Pittsburgh, you know, whether or not they have that persona prior to coming there, when they get there, it's tough. We're going to play tough. We're going to play hard. We're going to play soft. We're going to play 60 minutes. You know, we're gonna do all of that. And then when you look at those guys, it's an expectation. We expect to win. You know, I mean, we don't expect to. When we play the Bengals, we are expecting to win.
I think the Steelers go out of their way to draft Steeler type players. They go out and they draft the toughest guys they can find. The Bengals, I think, tend to draft the most talented guys they can find.
Yeah, the best guy available. As a fan, and you're looking, and you have, you know, better expectations of what you expect the outcome of the game to be, and then when they go in, and to me, it still comes back to toughness, man. And I couldn't, you know, there was times we had opportunities to execute, we're put in situations where it's mano a mano. And, you know, they out-toughed us. They out-physicaled us. And so, you know, as a result, you know, we go in and we lose. You know, we lose 29-14. We're looking, rather than being right in the thick of it, we're back in a familiar, unfortunately, a familiar place where we really didn't want to be.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, it's just hold on.
Hey,
the thing that strikes me though is we could be Indianapolis Colts fans, because the Colts are actually 10.5 points underdogs to the Bengals who quit. So we'll transition into this week, and I would say this. The Bengals better win this game against maybe the worst defense in football. Jacoby Brissett, I think, has played well for them. He's a lot better than Scott Tolzien, the guy that started out the year for him. But with no Andrew Luck, I mean, the Bengals are getting to play one of the teams that may be in more disarray than they are.
Absolutely. So this is after a game like that, and you know, I think the guys come back, and it's on their psyche. I don't care what you say. That wasn't a regular loss. That was against the Steelers, to a team that pretty much said in a prior game, we're going to beat you up, and then you got there, they beat you up, and then you quit and went home. They sent you home. So this is a game to bounce back. You know, after a whooping like that, you get a chance to go out and take it out on another opponent, and I think that's what they need to do. They need to go out. They need to click on all cylinders. You know, defense, offense, special teams, and they need to have a nice convincing. They can't make this game a close game. They need to go out there and come away with a convincing, dominating win and get on. At the end of the day, we can't, you know, cry about it. We can't worry about Pittsburgh week is over. We'll have them coming up in a couple months, and we have to take care of what's ahead of us right now, and that's Indianapolis on Sunday.
So you picking a Bengal victory here, Joe?
I'm going to go out on a limb, Mike. I'm going to go out on a limb.
See, you know what, Joe? The way they quit, to me, it kind of is a limb with them. I mean, because it's not the first time we've seen it this year, because I thought they packed it in against Baltimore, too.
Yeah. Baltimore, that was a weird game also. But this game, because if you look at this game, we sort of got our mojo back. We were back. You know, we had a little swag to us. We had a little confidence going into that game. And our pre-season expectations of ourselves of what we could become, we had it all going for us here in this Pittsburgh game. And then we go out there, and they totally take it to us. You know, that being said, you know, these guys got to come in on Sunday. The NFL is a league that it really stands for not so long. You got to have a short memory leave that game behind you, and you have to go on and Indianapolis, they're professionals. Even though their quarterback is out for the season, has played it all, they're still going to come in. They're still going to be professionals. And then if we still are sitting back and licking our wounds and talking about what happened last week, you know, it could be some trouble.
All right, well, real quick before we wrap the show up, we're going to take a second for a commercial break to check out our sponsor, Dr. Randall Fick in Cincinnati, Ohio. We'll be right back. All right, guys, we're back on the Cincinnati Bengals Weekly Show. We're at Week 8. The Bengals are getting ready to take on the Indianapolis Colts. Joe, even with everything I said right before the commercial break, I still think the Bengals probably win this game 34-7 by default. I don't see how the Colts are going to stop anybody. And the one good thing is their defensive line's not very good. I think their leading sack guy is Simon, the linebacker, who's got 3, and it looks like he may miss this game. So I think the Bengals get back on track and win this big time. The only question to me is the next 3 games are on the road, and that's where this season's going to be made or break. It's going to be make or break for those 3 road games.
Yeah, definitely. I totally agree. You know, I do see us, you know, coming out with a pretty easy victory. I think the offense can get to rolling on these guys. Like I said, I think also they can score, you know, 4 or 5 touchdowns. But knowing us, you know, I'm going to say we're going to score, you know, 4 touchdowns, a field goal, you know, 31. And unfortunately, defense, there's been a breakdown, Mike.
But they're going to be missing Kevin Minter now, too, for an extended period of time, it looks like.
Yeah, and unfortunately, we are giving up a big play. You see that the
Kirkpatrick was terrible.
Yeah, but you know, for a guy in the NFL to be wide open like that, there's a breakdown in coverage. So there's some things going on because that doesn't happen without, you know, there's a breakdown in communication. There's some turmoil, inner turmoil. You know, I have heard rumblings of some inner turmoil stuff in the locker room, and when you have a team like that, and you know, you have young guys making money, you know, there's this guy like this girl, and this other guy he likes the same girl, and you're young, you know, and you're dumb, and you're allowing, you know, stuff off the field to affect what's going on in the field, and you know, I look at it and it does. Any team, when you talk about all the teams that have success, go to the Super Bowl, that go to the playoffs, they are cohesive. They gel on the field, they gel in the locker room, they gel off the field. And I would say every successful team, you're going to have those three elements. It's not just on the field, it's in the locker room, and it's off the field. And anytime that you talk about successful teams, they're going to have those three elements, and you know, there's some rumblings of, you know, some little high school kind of stuff that I heard going on, and as a result, on defensively, and you see those breakdowns. You know, guys, I don't want to talk to this guy. I'm not talking to this guy. I'm mad at this guy, and obviously, there's some kind of communication breakdown for a guy to be that wide open. But every game, you know, it's been like that. So I'm looking for us to be dominant. But at the same time, breaking down a player two, and as a result, Indianapolis scoring at least two touchdowns. So you know, I'm gonna say they're gonna score two touchdowns, but I think we can outscore them, and looking something like 31-14.
All right, very good. I talked to Leon Searcy this morning. He may be on with us for the Bengals Jaguars preview coming up. I think it's next week. So
okay. Good deal. I'll be in Jacksonville for that. A little sunshine.
Well, he may be going to that too. I have to hook you guys up. Phone numbers. You can go down and hang out.
Yeah.
You can hang out with him. He was a Steeler though, so I don't know if you want to hang out with him too much.
Yeah, no, man. You know.
Yeah, if he was just a Jaguar, yeah, it'd be cool. But yeah. The fact he's a Steeler, I don't know.
Well, you know, I say this, you know, Mike, from, you know, he overall, you can talk about Steelers' dominance over the Bengals. But personally, you know, from 86, 87, 88, 89, you know, I think I got a little bragging room, you know, because we were beating pretty good. So, you know, I think I have a good argument. So at least,
yeah,
4 years.
I prefer the decade over the 80s myself. So. For
yeah.
Pretty much everything. But, yeah. All right, guys, so make sure you check us out for Week 9 next week on the Bengals Show. Make sure you check out Dr. Randall Fick, Springdale, Ohio, for all your chiropractic orthopedic needs. I want to remind everybody you can download our app on iTunes. You can hear all of our shows on iHeartRadio, Spreaker, Stitcher. Tune in wherever you hear sports podcasts. You'll find the grueling truth. So for Joe Kelly, this is Mike Goodpaster. You've been listening to The Grueling Truth, where the legend